Hello and welcome everyone to my channel Skanda Prasad. So now the time is around 11:40 and I've just prepared for making a video on chemistry board exam, especially for P block elements for 3 markers, because that is where students face a lot of problems. So I have decided to discuss around 15 to 16 problems which will surely cover entire P block elements for especially 3 markers, so that you all don't have any problem during the exam. And if you learn this much, I'm sure your 3 markers will go really well, because other things you can do it easily. I'm very much sure about it. So now please enjoy the video and keep a pencil and pen or pencil and a notebook, so that you can write down the important things. I've also told what to write and things which are important, and I've mentioned all of them in the video which is coming up. And with that note, let's begin. So hello everyone, in this video, as I've told you, I'll be picking up around 15 questions of P block elements, around 15 to 16 questions maybe, and all of them will be 3 marker type questions, because in board exams, 3 markers of P block is what all students face problems in. So let's begin. I have not written the questions, but I'll be directly just reading out the question and then discussing the answer, so that all of you are familiarized with it. And with that note, let's begin. The first question says, if you want to, you can write the question down by like slowing the speed using the option in YouTube, or else just you can listen to what I say, and whatever you feel is important, just write it down, because I'll be writing only those things which I feel is important. So you can just copy it down somewhere, and the same answers can be written in the board exams when you're writing the chemistry exam the next, I think it's on Tuesday, right? Yeah. So that day you can write the same answer, but just elaborate it a bit more wherever I've shortened the things. Let's see the first question. It says, white phosphorus is heated with excess of dry chlorine to get a compound called as X, right? And this is the first question. And X on hydrolysis gives an oxo acid of phosphorus Y. What are X and Y, and what is the basicity of that acid? Now what that I think is white phosphorus. Let's just take there are two types of phosphorus. I mean phosphorus, right? White and red, and there's a black phosphorus also. So they have taken white phosphorus, and with excess of dry chlorine, I'm not balancing the equation, I'm just telling this is taken in excess, and they tell we get a compound called as X. Now when phosphorus reacts with excess of chlorine, the compound formed is PCl5, because excess of chlorine, if controlled amount of chlorine is present, then it should be PCl3, right? Now PCl5 is the compound which is X. Now they are telling X on hydrolysis. Now if you hydrolyze this, like if you put H2O, you will get a compound called as H3PO4, and with that you will get HCl. That is not of our interest. Now H3PO4 is what is important for us. So this is compound Y. And they're asking what is the basicity of this acid. Basicity is 3, because if you draw the structure P, double bond O, OH, OH and OH. So 3 hydrogen it can give. So that means it is its basicity is 3. So this question is done. This is one type of question which can come, and high probability of coming also. Let's see the second question. It says, for the manufacturing of ammonia by Haber's process, draw the flowchart, and that's the first part. The second part is write the chemical equation for the reactions involved, and name the catalyst used. Now you know the flowchart. Okay, just let me write it fast. This is compression. What do we have to compress? N2 plus 3 times of H2. You know this is the equation, right? The original equation is N2 plus 3 times of H2 gives rise to 2 times of NH3. This is nothing but Haber's process for producing ammonia. Now after compression, we have to put this into the catalyst. I'll tell you what the catalyst is in a second. And from catalyst, we have to just condense it, so that we get liquid ammonia. That's what we need, right? And from this, after condensing, we get ammonia, NH3, which is in liquid form. And whatever is unused, that is N2 and 3 times of H2, unused N2 and H2 will be put back into the compressor, and this is nothing but Haber's process, right? Write the chemical equation. This is the chemical equation. And the catalyst used here is iron oxide. Iron oxide. And that's, we are done with that second question. Now the next question is, explain carrying action of concentrated sulfuric acid H2SO4 taken in concentrated form, carrying action on carbohydrate. Let's take a carbohydrate. We know that H2SO4 is a very strong dehydrating agent, and it removes water molecules from carbohydrates. Let's take an example for carbohydrates, that is C12H22O11. You know, this is the example taken in the NCERT also. When you put concentrated H2SO4, you get 12 times of carbon plus 11 times of H2O, and that's our final product. This is the first part of the third question, and the second part says complete the equation given below. The equation given here is 2 times of PbO2 upon heating gives something plus something. You have to find these two products. Well, the products are, this is dioxide, right? There are two oxygens. This will give rise to 2 times of PbO, just lead oxide, plus oxygen gas, that is O2. It's balanced, right? 2 Pb, 2 Pb, 4 oxygens and 4 oxygens, and that's it. So this was our third question answer. Just elaborate it and write it in words so that you get a maximum amount of marks. That is, you get full marks. Now let's see the fourth question, which says, which allotropic form of phosphorus has discrete tetrahedral P4 molecules? You know that it is white phosphorus itself. White phosphorus has discrete tetrahedral P4 molecules. Discrete, right? This was the first part of the question. And the next half is, how is phosphine prepared in laboratory? Give the equation. Phosphine is nothing but PH3. You need to remember that this is a poisonous gas. That's one thing. How it is prepared in laboratory? So the equation is P4 plus, you have to react, make it to react with the base. Let's take NaOH, 3 times of NaOH, plus you have to just hydrolyze it so that the medium is aqueous. So H2O, when we balance, we'll get this. So obviously you have to get PH3, because that is what is our final answer. And the byproduct is NaH2PO2. This is 3 times. This is the product. Please remember this. All you have to do is just explain this in words. And that, we are done with our fourth question. Let's move on to fifth question. The fifth question says, complete the following equations. This is a very, very expected question. High chances that this will come. And the first equation they have asked us to complete is 2KClO3. Upon heating with manganese oxide, dioxide, and heat, what will be our answer? Our answer should be 2KCl plus 3 times of O2, right? This is our answer. Just remove KCl, and 2O3 you can see here, that is oxygen has to come out somehow. So how will it come? 3 molecules of oxygen gas will be released. That's it. This is the first part of the equation. I'm sure you would have seen this question many times, but still I'm just explaining. The second reaction is SO2 plus Cl2. This gives, both are in solid form. SO2 is in gaseous form, and both are in gaseous form. I'm sorry, I told solid accidentally. So this gives SO2 Cl2. This is the product. Just combine both of them, that's it. And the third equation they've asked us to complete is SO3 plus concentrated H2SO4. Now this gives us a compound called as oleum, that is H2S2O7. You know that oleum is used in preparation of H2SO4. That this is nothing but oleum. Remember the equation. This was our fifth question. If you just answer these three questions, if it comes, easily you get 3 marks, right? Now let's see the sixth question, which says, the first part of the question is, give 2 reasons for anomalous behavior of fluorine. Well, I'm sure your teachers must have also explained this around 100 times. The only reasons which result in anomalous behavior of let it be fluorine, or let it be nitrogen or oxygen or lithium or any such kind of thing. The only reasons is small size, high electronegativity, and we can say the they're asking in case of fluorine, right? Fluorine-fluorine bond dissociation enthalpy is very less. That is bond energy. That's very less. And what else can we say? We can also say that it can't expand its octet because it hasn't got any empty d orbitals. That is non-availability. Please write it of d orbitals in valence shells. Valence shells. It is not there. These are the four reasons for any atom if they take off like the first. In the respective groups, if you take the first element, these are the only reasons which are possible. So, for any element, these are the only reasons which you are supposed to write even in the exam. This was our sixth question. And the second part of this question was, give an example for one mono, not mono, give an example for one oxo acid of chlorine. Oxo acid means of chlorine, so chlorine must be present. Oxygen must be present. Since it's an acid, hydrogen also should be present. So what are the compounds which you can form from this? They have asked you to just give one. You can write HOCl or HClO2 is possible, HClO3 is possible, HClO4 is possible. Well, this is the strongest acid present, right, in the whole world. HClO4 is the strongest acid present. Please remember that also. So these are the oxo acids. Just write any one of them if they ask. Now this, with this we come to the end of sixth question. Let's see the seventh question. The seventh question says, name the gas liberated when concentrated HCl is heated with MnO2. Concentrated HCl plus MnO2. What is the, name the gas which comes out. That is nothing but chlorine itself. Chlorine gas is released. This is the preparation method of chlorine. Please remember. They may ask a question like that also. And give the equation for the reaction. That's also they are asking. So the reaction is MnO2. I'm talking about the balanced reaction. Plus 4 times of HCl. Gives rise to MnCl2. Plus Cl2. And let's see what else is remaining. Mn is done. So Mn, these two are done. And Cl2 is done. 4 times of chlorine is done, so this is done. So we are remaining with the 4 hydrogens and 2 oxygens. All you can do is 4 hydrogen and 2 oxygen will be combined as a water two water molecules. So this was the equation, and they are also asking, name the reagent used to obtain bleaching powder from chlorine. Well, that is dry slaked lime. Dry slaked lime. You know that quick lime is CaO and slaked lime is calcium hydroxide. Just if you take this in dry form, you can get bleaching powder from chlorine. If you make chlorine react with this, you get bleaching powder. That is CaOCl2. You know that, right? So this was all about 7th question. Let's move on to 8th question, which says, the 8th question is, describe with the equations manufacturing of nitric acid by Ostwald's process. This is really very important question. High chances of this coming. Either Haber's process or Ostwald's process or contact process. Any of these three can come. Haber's process is for ammonia, and Ostwald's process is for nitric acid, and contact process is for H2SO4, that is sulfuric acid. So one of these three are bound to come. So please learn, and please pay attention to this question also. Well, I'm just writing the equations. You have to explain this by yourself in words. The equation is 4NH3 plus 5O2. See, the only thing which in this reaction you have to do is just keep on oxidizing whatever you get. So first you take ammonia, you need to get nitric acid, right? That is HNO3. So from ammonia you have to start, you have to oxidize this. Just remember the compound first, later you can balance, there's no problem. You will get NO plus H2O. When you balance, you will get 4NO and 6H2O. And you have to write the reaction conditions also, that is platinum gas catalyst. Gauge catalyst, and the temperature is 500 Kelvin and 9 bar. This is really very important. If you don't write this, they'll surely cut your marks. So this was the first step. The next step is you have to take NO and make it to react with oxygen again, and you'll get NO2. If you balance, you'll get 2NO plus O2 gives rise to 2NO2. See, start with ammonia, oxidize. Whatever you get, again oxidize this. And once you get NO2, you can't further oxidize this, because it's already in plus 4 oxidation state, and all you have to do is just hydrolyze this so that you get an acid, right? So this is already acidic. You know that non-metal oxides are acidic and metal oxides are basic. So this is a non-metal oxide and it should be acidic. If you just hydrolyze, this is in gaseous form. If you put water into it, it will become an acid. So you have to take NO2 and put some water and you will get HNO3. This is the final equation. But the thing is, one byproduct extra which comes is again NO. This can be reutilized. So if you balance, you will get 3. And no coefficient for this, and 2 times of HNO3, and you are done with the Ostwald's process. Ostwald's process. Right, now we are done with 8th question. Let's move on to 9th question. Complete the following reactions. Okay, these were the same questions. This will KClO3 becomes KCl plus O2. Okay, I don't have to do this again. So this question, almost same repetition of what I did in the previous page. I think that was the 5th question, and they have actually repeated it. So this question was asked again, so I am not going to discuss this. And let's see the next question, which says, write the chemical equations in the manufacture of concentrated sulfuric acid by contact process. Now we have to see the reactions of how contact process is done to produce H2SO4. Let's begin. The first step is we have to take some sulfur and start oxidizing it again. How will you oxidize? By adding oxygen, obviously. So you will get S plus O2 equal to SO2. Right? This is the first step. The second step is take SO2 and oxidize it again with oxygen. But in this case, you have to take some catalyst, that is vanadium pentoxide. V2O5. In presence of platinum, and that pressure should be around 2 to 3 atmospheres. You will get 2 times of SO3. This is the first step. This is the second step. So this question is, which question is it? We are discussing 8, 9, 10th question. 9th question is same, so this is 10th question. So we get SO3, and for this, remember that delta H equal to negative. That is, it is an exothermic process. And the final step is absorption of SO3 in 98% of concentrated H2SO4. See, the only irony in this is you are using H2SO4 in the reaction to produce further H2SO4. If you see the figure also, in the textbook it is given, in your NCRT textbooks, the whole figure, there is a block diagram for preparation of H2SO4 by contact process. In that, at a place you are spraying the H2SO4 again, for production of further H2SO4. That is the only irony in this. So the SO3 is again added with H2SO4, and what you get is oleum, H2S2O7. I discussed about this in the previous few questions before, right? This is oleum, and from oleum H2S2O7, if you hydrolyze this, that is when you get H2SO4. This is in a little more pure form, and the impurity in this is less, so it is pure than what we used here, right? So remember the equations and just explain it in your own words. That is what is important in board exams. If you don't explain in words, you won't get marks. So this was the 10th question. The 11th question is nothing but explain the same thing in block diagram. If I start doing block diagram, it will be very difficult and it will be very time consuming. So just open your NCRT books and just practice the block diagram once more, so that you are done. So 11th question will be done, and 12th question is mention any two anomalous properties of nitrogen. In this case, same thing, it is small size, high electronegativity electronegativity, and high ionization enthalpy, and non-availability of d orbitals. The same thing, just see from the previous go behind some 5 to 6 minutes, you'll get the answers. Same thing it is, small size, high electronegativity, everything. They just asked to, you can write how many ever you want, so you can impress the evaluator. Well, he won't get impressed, I'm just joking. So, this is the first part of the question. The second part of the question is, write the structure of orthophosphoric acid. Now, orthophosphoric acid, I've already discussed that is nothing but H3PO4. Its structure is P double bond O, OH, OH, and OH. This is nothing but orthophosphoric acid, or you can just call it as phosphoric acid. This was about 12th question. Now let's see the 13th question. 13th question says, which is the strongest acid among the hydrogen halides? You know, hydrogen halides are like, we can in general we can represent it as X. X can be fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, like that. So they're asking which is the strongest acid among these. Either it is HF or HCl or HBr or HI. Clearly the answer should be HI, because I is a very big atom. I can, just for representation, I can write it as like this, and H is very small comparatively. So the bond between these two is very weak. When comparable sizes are there, they get bonded easily, and the overlapping of orbitals is very strong. But if one is very big and one is very small, bond will be kind of very weak. So just all you have to do is just give a little amount of energy so that they dissociate. When they dissociate, what do you get? I minus and H plus. If you get H plus, what do you mean? What does it mean? It means that it is acidic, and if it gives H plus easily, it is more acidic. That is what we get from this logic. So HI has the least bond dissociation energy, and hence it is highly acidic. Now, the second part of the same question says, write the structure of chloric acid. Now, chloric acid is nothing but, remember, it's not chlorous acid or perchloric acid, it's not that. They are just asking chloric acid. The formula is HClO3. Now, how do you draw the structure of HClO3? Take Cl as the central atom, and double bond O, double bond O. There are totally 7 electrons in the outer shell of chlorine. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 are done, and we have to give 5 for this O and for this H, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and a lone pair of electrons will still remain on the chlorine atom itself. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and this is nothing but an OH group, so, and only this hydrogen is feasible to give it as H plus, and this is an acid, that is HClO3, chloric acid. Chloric acid. Now this is about 13th question. Let's go for 14th one. 14th question says, name the explosive product formed when excess chlorine reacts with ammonia. Ammonia plus this is excess of chlorine should give us NCl3, right? And if you balance this, you'll get 2 times this and 3 times this. So 2 times NCl3 plus 3 times of H2. This is the product, and this is the explosive product which is formed, that is NCl3. This is the first part of the question. The second part says, arrange the following acids in the increasing order of the acidic strength. The acids are HBr, HCl, HI, HF. I don't have to tell you that HF is most acidic and HCl is least acidic. Just go on in the same order as that of the elements. And the next part is, third part of the question is, what is aqua regia? Well, you know that aqua regia is the mixture of concentrated HNO3 and concentrated HCl. Both you have to mix in the ratio of 1:3. That is, if you take one equivalent of HNO3, consequently you have to put 3 equivalent of HCl, so that you get aqua regia. So this was about the 14th question. Let's see the last and the 15th question. That is pH 3 forms bubbles when passed slowly in water, but NH3 dissolves in water. Please explain why. That is what is given. Now, they are telling pH3 forms bubbles. Bubbles, it indicates that something is escaping out of the beaker, right? And NH3 dissolves. Dissolves means nothing is escaping. It is getting mixed with whatever is there in the beaker. In this case, it is water. Now, if I draw the structure of water, it is something like this, right? And they are telling ammonia dissolves in water. What is the structure of ammonia? N, H, H and H. Now, why does it dissolve? That is because there is a formation of hydrogen bonding. That is, oxygen is one. I told this in numerous videos that FON is what you have to remember. That is the order of electronegativity, in that order: greatest, middle, and then least. Out of these three elements, F is most electronegative, and N is the least electronegative, in this order. Right, now these two are bonded in this way, as well as this hydrogen can be bonded to nitrogen. This is just an attraction, that's all. Coulombic attraction kind of thing, that is delta negative and delta positive. So this is called as hydrogen bond, and hence since bonding is there, their strength becomes more, and hence it dissolves inside the water. But pH3, if you take pH3, this will not form hydrogen bond, because phosphorus is not as electronegative as nitrogen and hence cannot form and hence cannot create a delta positive charge on hydrogen. It can't pull the electrons very much, so that oxygen will start forming the hydrogen bond. So this is not possible in this case, and hence pH 3 it escapes from the beaker as gas, and hence you can see bubbles. So this was the reason. And the second part of the same question is, write structure of pyrophosphoric acid. The structure is OH, P double bond O, O, P double bond O. It's just symmetric, that's it. And again here OH, OH. The formula is H4P2O7, right? This is the structure. And pyrophosphoric acid is given by this compound. And please, I think there should be a table or something in the textbook. Or if not, they have given the structures. Please make a table of it and learn all the structure of each compound, that is pyrophosphoric acid, pyrophosphorus acid. All different acids are there, even for nitrogen as well as for chlorine acids also. All the different types of acids, just remember the structures, because they can ask any one of them. So this has become already a 25 minute video. I hope this was helpful. So that I think if you learn this, these many questions properly, I think your 3 markers should be done. And from metallurgy also questions will be asked, such as like explain the Hall-Herold process or something like that. Please learn those also. But P block elements is what people face difficulty with. So that's what I've discussed. And I'd like to apologize for a little bit long video, but still you can increase the speed to 2x speed or 1.75x just for the revision. I've made this video just for revision. Please note all these down and start practicing, and write it down once in your notebook where you practice, so that it stays with you. With that note, I'd like to end the video. And if you have just stumbled upon this video, don't forget to like and share this video with your friends also, so that even they don't miss out with this excellent video which I'm posting. And finally, thanks a lot for watching this video. Thank you. Don't forget to subscribe also. Thank you.